April is coming to a close, and so is National Poetry Month. But Poetry on In the Moment doesn't end in April, of course. However, I am particularly pleased to welcome our next guest to the studio during National Poetry Month. Frank Pommersheim is a professor and a poet, a legal scholar, and a haiku guru. I have his latest correspondence in my hands, and I have the Buddha in the Kirby family studio with me for a few delightful moments. Welcome back to In the Moment. Thanks for being here.
Thank you so much for inviting me, Lori. It's a delight to be here.
Tell us a little bit, for people who have not been following your work as long as I have, when did you start? You're a professor of law at the University of South Dakota Law School, emeritus now. How early was poetry part of your life?
Well, it always has, but it became, I think, most important to me when we started to have children. And because you have such intense experiences with your children, I wanted a way to remember those experiences. And it just seemed to me, by writing poetry about my children, hopefully poetry is concentrated enough that it could sort of capture the intensity of the experience with my children. And when I look back at some of those early poems, I think just from my own subjective point of view, it actually worked. And so I was encouraged to keep going in that direction. And then along the way, at some point, these Buddha poems kind of blossomed. I don't know quite where that came from. And so the Buddha poems, the haiku poems, have become kind of the kind of method of poetic expression I've used in recent years.
For me personally, finding one of the volumes of the Buddha correspondence in the USD bookstore years ago there was just something about the packaging, something about the trim size, something about what was in there that felt like the thing I didn't know I needed. So maybe that's a reader thing that kind of caught on more than, and you fortunately have responded to it. You've met the demand of your fans, that is to say. Have you studied haiku? Here's my real question. Do you study haiku by reading it and writing it, or do you study haiku by classroom study and a book about haiku? What's more useful?
Well,
a little bit
of both. I mean, I never took a course in haiku or a course in Buddha, but you know, I read fairly widely, and I became aware of haiku poetry. And for me, I was quite taken with the intensity of that kind of expression, you know, basically to create an image or a thought or two and then just leave it. They're seldom kind of resolved. And I liked that notion. And I think for readers, it's a wide open kind of space. They're also quick. The idea is to capture a moment and see what happens both for you as the writer and for any potential reader. The Buddha thing is a little bit broader. People often ask me, I guess it's a compliment, am I a Buddhist? And I wouldn't say I'm a Buddhist, but I'm a person interested in Buddha and Buddhism. The notion that many things are fleeting, also to be captured in a moment. Quite different from sort of the Judeo-Christian kind of framework. And so I like the notion of Buddha as a persona, Buddha as a funny person, as a dry person, as a thoughtful person, those kind of things. And just over the years, the response has been wonderful to me. People have been really interested in Buddha in the chapbooks. And so it's encouraged me to go on. You know, I've developed this little Buddha mailing list. You're on it, Lori. You know, I send out triptychs kind of twice a year. And, you know, that mailing list, it sounds unreal or surreal. It's up to about 500.
Oh, wow.
And just send them out. And, you know, people have been kind for the most part in their responses. Yeah.
Well, let's send some out to the listeners of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. I'm hoping you'll read for us. And I'm just going to sit back and give it space between and let people think about it, and please.
Yeah, sure. I mean, jump in at any time. Yeah. The first one is the one that opens this most recent chapbook, which is called Idleness of a Recluse Poet. And that phrase is not really a phrase from me. There's a tradition, or was a tradition, in Chinese poetry where oftentimes public servants would serve in metropolises and have a public life, and then at some point they would leave or be asked to leave, and they would go to the country and live in the country, drink wine, be a recluse, be idle, and write poetry. And for me, on some level, that seemed like a wonderful combination to have a professional life in which you're serving and then go from the city to the country, reflect, drink wine, write short poems for reasons I can't explain, and I'm not interested in explaining. I'm not interested in anyone analyzing what I'm saying either. It just seemed to me a kind of wonderful balance to have in one's life. And so the first poem in this collection is Buddha's Ode to Craft. How does Buddha actually think about craft that he's using and striving to embody? Buddha's Ode to Craft. Brushstroke, few words, faint grammar, spirit work, conjured and made with human hands. The next Buddha poem was titled Buddha Feeds Breadcrumbs to the Birds.
I love this one.
Breadcrumbs, then birds. Something finds you, nourishes, then flies away. And for me, part of it's just an observation, but it's how the observation, what meaning it takes on in terms of how how something just finds you, me, and it nourishes us, and, you know, it's gone. We don't know why it came. We don't know where it's going, but we're grateful that somehow it was able to nourish us. And that's what I was striving to do in that particular poem. This is called Buddha Embraces the Sabbath, and it kind of is after the well-known writer, rabbi, and activist Abraham Herschel. So Buddha embraces the Sabbath. Praise without petition, peace without war, prayer without end. And the next poem reflects a deliberate attempt on my part to write a poem for my students, and particularly for my Indian law students over these many, many years. And so it's called Buddha Sends a Hunter-Gatherer Poem to Professor Pommersheim's Indian Law Class. Cut complicity, gather reason, seek balance, show respect, find spirit, pour it all out.
I want to jump in quickly because I'm taking a trip tomorrow. Jackie Hendry's going to host the show for me. And I'm getting on a plane, and I was planning what I would bring on the plane. And normally you think, like, what is the book that's going to keep me engaged for the whole flight? If there's a, and that's usually something kind of hefty or entertaining and light, depending on the mood that you're in. And this is not going to take up much space in my in my carry-on. But say something before we wrap up. We only have like 30 more seconds about the meditation that happens after the poem.
Well, you know, it's just however it works for you and for me as the writer. You know, it comes to you and then maybe it leaves right away. And if it has resonance or reverberation, it will come back to you at some time to say, oh, this recalls this particular moment, this particular poem. So it's hard to say. You know, in terms of that poem that I just read, I wrote for my students, I was quite amazed. And I made it into a bookmark and gave it to all my students. And I told them that they had to put it under their pillow when they went to sleep so that Buddha and Indian law would be in their ear, even when they were sleeping.
Yeah.
And I was also surprised and honored to see that there are one or two faculty members who just ripped the poem out of his originally in, of all places, the South Dakota Law Review, and put it on their door. And one of the bookmarks the dean of law school actually has on his door. And so for me, those are just powerful things that, you know, it's reaching people. So
Frank Pommersheim, come back again. I mean, it's not Poetry Month. Come back often, seasonally. Mm-hmm. Love your work. It means a lot to me personally. It means a lot that you joined us here today.
Well, thank you so much, Laurie. Travel safely, and may Buddha be with you.
And thank you for listening.